When I say Sweden, you most probably think of IKEA, ABBA, and stinky canned fish. But the country actually pulled off another remarkable feat that deserves more attention.
Sweden is the best performer in Europe when it comes to reducing greenhouse gas emissions.
Sweden already emitted 5 times less CO2 per capita than the European average back in 1990. Since then, Sweden has reduced its net greenhouse gas emissions by another 80%, while the average reduction in the EU has only been 30%. At the same time, Sweden's economy has grown twofold.
You don't need to reduce welfare to reduce your climate impact. That is a message to the world that's so important.
And that's not all. They set themselves the world's toughest climate target and are on track to meet it. So what is Sweden doing better than others? Let's take a look at how it became a role model on climate and what other countries can learn from this success story. Sweden has some natural advantages. I mean, just look at all of that lush green forest. 70% of Sweden is forest land. And forests are very useful when it comes to reducing greenhouse gas emissions because they remove CO2 from the atmosphere. The country is also blessed with a lot of wind. Just look at that long coastline. And then there are all these big lakes, perfect for hydropower. But it wasn't just hitting the natural resources jackpot that got the country to where it is now. Sweden realized its natural potential early on and started investing in renewable energy sources much earlier than many other countries.
Sweden has had hydropower for more than a century.
That's Matthias Goldman, founder of the Swedish 2030 Secretariat, which ensures that the transport sector reaches its climate targets by 2030. Add in other sources of clean energy, and you get why Sweden hardly burns any fossil fuels for electricity anymore.
Sweden started very early to cut out fossil fuels from our energy mix.
That's Orsa Persson, who advises the Swedish government on climate policy and rates its performance.
This started already in the 70s when Sweden built out nuclear. Quite a lot.
Back then, the global oil crisis hit, and countries were looking for other sources of energy.
So that's helped to Sweden to cut out oil from our energy mix.
Today, almost 70% of Sweden's electricity comes from renewables, especially hydropower and wind. The rest of its electricity demand is met by nuclear power.
The greenhouse gas emissions of the electricity production are almost zero right now. So they are almost not using any fossil fuels for producing electricity.
That's Jorge de Skreba, an energy expert from the European Environment Agency.
If you compare it with other countries, that's in a whole other world.
What's most stunning, though, is that Sweden managed to clean up its act while also growing its economy.
So that's what we call decoupling.
And all of this in a heavily industrialized country, which makes steel, cement, and cars.
So we need cheap electricity, and by having it on our own, not importing fossil fuels, doing it on our own, doing it with sources that are there naturally, we keep prices down and we keep supplies up.
It's this combination of innovative climate and industrial policy that sets Sweden apart, but more on that later. Sweden didn't just get rid of fossil fuels in its electricity production, but also when it comes to providing heat for buildings and industrial processes. And that's quite special for a cold country.
But even then, we see that the emissions that are emitted for the heat production in the housing sector is very limited compared to other countries.
So, what was the trick there? The first step was that Sweden invested in district heating systems early on, which is more efficient. This means that instead of having a heater in each home, you build big centralized heaters that are connected to lots of houses and industrial areas through insulated pipes and underground infrastructure.
And this is quite a big undertaking. You need the government and the private sector to work together to provide this infrastructure.
It's also quite expensive. Just think of all the piping you need to lay across entire neighborhoods. Nonetheless, the government decided to go for this approach early on and stuck with it.
Yeah, they saw the benefits of having these bigger system solutions. Sweden, as a cold country, had a real incentive to have a sort of energy efficient, sort of rational heating system in place to serve inhabitants.
Sweden also tightened its building standards in the 70s to improve insulation and keep the heat inside. Windows and houses were exchanged for 3-pane windows, and walls and roofs were made thicker. In the 1990s, the country then invested in clean energy sources, again. The good thing about district heating is that you can switch up the fuels that are being used. In the past, they relied on fossil fuels like oil and coal. But now, 97% of the heating in Sweden comes from biofuels and burning waste. And in the past 20 years, heat pumps have also become very popular in Sweden. Hardly anywhere else in Europe are they used as much per capita as in Sweden, where more than half of all residential houses have installed them. These kind of work like a reverse AC, and they run on electricity.
And then you electrify the heat demand, and there's no direct greenhouse gas emissions related to that.
So in the last 30 years, the emissions from electricity and heating, which is often a difficult sector for many countries, Sweden managed to reduce emissions by 70% in 30 years' time. So that also shows that big, big, bold changes are possible.
And these big, bold changes didn't come out of thin air. Sweden has implemented clear climate policies since the 1990s, such as introducing one of the world's first, and by now, one of the world's highest carbon taxes, charging industries and individuals for the carbon dioxide they emit.
We realized that combating climate change cannot be a huge cost for the government. Then we will fight and struggle between should we focus on schooling, healthcare, and so forth, or should we focus on combating climate change. So when the carbon tax was first discussed, it very early on became a very wide agreement that this is the way forward. And since then, we've never looked back. There's not a single party in Swedish politics that even questioned the carbon tax.
A 2019 empirical case study found that the Swedish carbon tax had a significant impact on CO2 emissions. It was responsible for a 6% decline of emissions from transport in an average year. And it sped up the changes we talked about earlier, like in the energy and heating sector, by giving people and businesses the incentive to invest in renewable energy instead of fossil fuels.
There's a clear message for us. Either we do something that's bad for the environment and we have to pay the tax, or do we do something that's better and we're not taxed.
And the carbon tax sparked innovation that put Sweden's industry ahead.
Almost 10% of Sweden's climate impact comes from the steel industry because it uses fossil fuels. But Sweden now aims to become the world's first in producing large quantities of fossil-free steel using green hydrogen instead of the fossil fuels.
Ambitious environmental policy has been increasing Sweden's competitiveness, really. The fact that Sweden has a strong environmental legacy means that there is a large community of business and research innovators that are keen on developing these new technologies and products and also business models to make it work.
This also translates to the way Sweden is investing in its future.
There's quite a large focus in the schools, in the educational system, on engineering and on scientific technologies. And we see, for example, that Sweden has quite a lot of expertise when it comes to some specific forms of renewable energy, for example, tidal renewable energy.
And while in many countries the public would revolt against any new tax, acceptance in Sweden has been high. And this is true across the political spectrum. 7 out of 8 parties agreed on the world's most stringent climate target in 2017 already, to be net zero by 2045.
That is a very tough target. It's a world-leading target that gave business and citizens a strong belief in that this is actually going to continue happening and that I can invest in it, knowing that even with a change of government, it will still stand. And that is so relevant because many citizens around the world will wonder, okay, what happens after the next election? But when you have a wide political buy-in, you also get the buy-in from the citizens and the business sector.
So, it really seems like Sweden can't set a foot wrong when it comes to climate policy. Or can they? Well, yes. Agriculture is one sector where there's been little to no progress when it comes to reducing emissions. But the country's biggest problem child is the transport sector. That's where most of Sweden's emissions currently come from. And it's an important sector. After all, Sweden may not have many people, but it's a country of long distances. But despite ambitious targets, progress is slow.
We are expecting to see increased emissions again, from the transport sector.
For years, Sweden had been introducing incentives to reduce transport emissions without the state having to pay for them.
For instance, in Sweden, over the years, if you bought an electric or biogas car, you would be given a bonus by the government. But if you chose to still have or to buy a new gas-guzzling SUV, you would instead pay an extra tax. And so the money given to the best cars was paid for by the money coming from the worst cars.
But lately, Sweden seems to be undoing some of these successes, specifically in the transport sector.
We are increasing emissions by roughly 5 million tons of carbon dioxide per year. In fact, this is the biggest increase in emissions in the history of Sweden.
Sweden's new conservative government, which came into power in September 2022, has rolled back some important policies in light of recent crises. It has lowered petrol and diesel taxes by a quarter, which means Sweden now has among the lowest prices on diesel and gasoline in Europe. It also introduced other measures that make it less expensive to drive a car, while abolishing the incentives that were previously offered to buy electric vehicles.
In 2022, we had a perfect storm in Sweden. We had very expensive fossil fuels, partially thanks to the war in Ukraine, we had high electricity prices, and we had an economy that was struggling. So with all those factors in mind, the politicians thought it would be helpful for them to get elected with a promise of cheaper fossil fuels.
On the bright side, the government also promised that these new measures will only be short-term and will be lifted again as soon as Sweden's economy kicks back up. They're already discussing other solutions for supporting struggling households and businesses. And if they keep that promise, Sweden will hopefully be on track to meet its targets for the transport sector again, a reduction of 70% of emissions between 2010 and 2030. So yeah, Sweden is an almost perfect role model in terms of climate policy.
Sweden, I think, illustrates that yes, it's indeed possible to produce electricity without any greenhouse gas emissions at all, and it's maybe an example for other countries in the world.
But how applicable is Sweden's approach? After all, every country faces its own unique challenges and might not have the same resources. But they very likely have other things.
Find where your main climate impact is and where you can make the biggest difference. Find what is your sort of unique selling point as a country, where is your entry point, and build on that.
Sweden's experience can also show that it pays off in the long run when the state introduces tough climate policies.
That will give you the green businesses, the green jobs, the billions in export income that you can use for other things that you want. Better welfare, better schooling, and so forth.
And this can only work if all of society is on board.
The biggest lesson is that you need close cooperation between government, private sector, and the local government as well to really develop these system solutions together and take risk, make these big long-term investments. That has been a success factor behind Sweden's decarbonization.
So, do you think this approach could work in your country? Let us know in the comments and subscribe. We post videos like this every Friday.